Harper Audio presents Bitter Brew, The Rise and Fall of Anheuser-Busch and America's Kings of Beer by William Knoedelseder. Read by Peter Berkrot. Prologue. August is not feeling well. In the grand ballroom of the Hyatt at Capitol Hill in Washington, D.C., on the afternoon of May 13, 2008, several hundred Anheuser-Busch distributors sat in rows of uncomfortable chairs, restlessly awaiting the arrival of August Busch IV, the 43-year-old president and CEO of Anheuser-Busch Incorporated, America's premier brewery. The fourth, as he was commonly called in the industry, was 20 minutes late, and no one from the company had appeared with an explanation for the delay. The distributors were among 1,200 beer professionals from around the world attending the 18th annual National Beer Wholesalers Association Brewers Legislative Conference. This year's three-day event coincided with the 75th anniversary of the repeal of Prohibition, and Anheuser-Busch had taken the opportunity to schedule a separate meeting with its distributors, the independent operators who, by a law passed in Prohibition's wake, serve as the middlemen between the brewery and retailers. There was much to talk about. Beer sales were on the decline globally, and the industry was weathering a period of rapid consolidation that threatened AB's century-long dominance. In the past few years, Milwaukee's Miller Brewing had merged with London-based South African breweries to form Sab Miller. Canada's Molson had merged with Colorado-based Adolph Coors to form Molson Coors, which then merged its U.S. operations with Sab Miller to form Miller Coors. And Belgium's Interbrew SA had merged with Brazil's Ambev to create InBev, which had knocked AB out of its perennial position as the world's largest brewer. AB was still the most profitable brewer, with its brands accounting for about 50% of beer sales in the United States, the world's most lucrative market. But the company's drop to number two in volume, coupled with the fact that its stock price had remained flat for nearly 5 years, or roughly the period that August the 4th had been in charge of the brewing division, was fueling speculation that the aggressively acquisitive InBev was eyeing AB as a possible takeover target. Busch had dismissed the talk of a takeover during a meeting with distributors in Chicago the week before, drawing a standing ovation when he declared, "Not on my watch." The fourth was actually the sixth Busch to head the St. Louis-based brewery, a responsibility handed down from father to firstborn son, since his great-great-grandfather, Adolphus, founded the company in the wake of the Civil War. With the exception of the fourth's great-uncle, Adolphus III, each of his predecessors had left an indelible imprint, not just on the company, but on American commerce as well. Over the course of five generations, they'd taken a tiny bankrupt brewery that made bad-tasting beer on the banks of the Mississippi River and transformed it into a colossus that pumped out more than 100 million barrels a year. They had steered the company through two world wars, Prohibition, and the Great Depression, building their signature lager, Budweiser, into the best-selling beer on the planet, making Anheuser-Busch, in the words of the fourth's father, August A. Busch III, the world's beer company. Thanks to their beer, the Busch family had tasted all that America ever promised the immigrant class from which they sprang. Wealth almost beyond comprehension, political power that provided access to presidents, and a lifestyle rivaling that of history's most extravagant royals. Along with that, of course, came a king-sized portion of heartbreak, scandal, tragedy, and untimely death. But they had endured. Nearly all the other German immigrant brewers who'd built their businesses by hand branded their factories with their family names: Schlitz, Miller, Pabst, Blatz, Schaefer, Coors, Lemp, Stroh, Ham, Grisadec, and turned America into a beer-loving nation, were gone, their paternalistic empires swallowed up by foreign-based conglomerations of amalgamations with soulless names like InBev. Of the brewing giants that boomed after Prohibition and fought fierce and sometimes desperate battles for market share in the last half of the 20th century, only Anheuser-Busch remained as a freestanding independent company, still operated by the family that founded it. So a lot was riding on the shoulders of August Anheuser-Busch IV, as the audience at the Hyatt waited for him to make his appearance. His watch had come at a portentous time for the company, bridging a glorious past and a perilous future. His vision going forward could determine the fate of the distributors' families and the families of thousands of AB employees and suppliers. 30 minutes into the wait, one of the fourth's trusted lieutenants, Vice President of Marketing David Peacock, materialized at the podium and apologized for the tardiness. He explained vaguely that the company plane had had trouble landing at the airport and promised, "August will be here shortly." He then added that Busch was taking medication for a sinus infection. The audience registered a collective, "Huh?" at the seeming non sequitur, and it quickly became apparent that Peacock was vamping for time. Another 10 minutes passed before Busch finally entered the room from stage left, surrounded by his ever-present phalanx of inner circle executives, the entourage, as they were called inside the company. Tanned and perfectly coiffed, wearing his trademark open-neck dress shirt, slacks, and cowboy boots, he stepped up to the microphone and, barely acknowledging the audience, launched into his prepared remarks. Casual about rehearsing for his public speaking engagements, Busch was known for sometimes going off script, losing focus, and relying on his good looks and charm to get him through. Most often he had not even looked at the speech before reading it in the teleprompter. Once, in an appearance before the Beer Institute in Boca Raton, Florida, he was supposed to say, "When our forefathers arrived on these shores, one of the first things they did was to erect a beer house." What came out of his mouth instead was, "When our forefathers arrived on these shores with erections." He laughed off the arguably Freudian flub. "Did I really say that?" And many in the audience laughed along with him. But his 27-year-old wife, Kate, sitting next to him on the dais, dropped her forehead to the table in embarrassment. There was no laughter on this day. From the outset, it was clear that something was wrong. As Busch attempted to address the effect of the slowing economy on the beer business, he slurred words and stumbled over phrases. At first, some in the audience thought he was having trouble with the teleprompter, but it soon seemed that the fourth was seriously impaired, and not from overindulging in an AB product or taking some mysterious sinus medication. No, this appeared to be a deep state of stoned. Unmindful of the rising murmur and the concerned looks on the faces in the crowd, he plowed on for several excruciating minutes, speaking in a kind of slow-mo monotone. Finally, mercifully, David Peacock intervened. He leaned into the microphone and said, "Obviously, August is not feeling well." He then took Busch by the arm and led him off the stage. Busch went docilely, stumbling once before he disappeared from view. The meeting was over, but the audience remained seated, stunned, absorbing the impact of a quintessential holy shit moment. It wasn't so much that Busch was bombed. His reputation as a party animal stretched back to his college days, when a Chappaquiddick-type incident left a 22-year-old cocktail waitress lying dead in a roadside ditch next to Busch's overturned Corvette, and Busch, who had walked away from the scene, telling police investigators hours later that he couldn't remember what happened or who was driving his car. His father had extricated him from that jam, and a number of others over the years, and AB security men had cleaned up countless lesser messes that the third was never told about. In a way, bad boy behavior was expected of the fourth, He was a Bush, after all. A member of a family in which hard drinking, fast driving, womanizing, and gunplay were part of the male curriculum. Both his father and his grandfather, the legendary beer baron August A. Gussie Bush Jr., had hard-earned reputations as hellraisers in their youth. But the incident at the Hyatt was different. It crossed a line that hadn't been crossed before. All of the Fourth's previous escapades could be dismissed as after-hours personal indiscretions. But this occurred on the job, in the course of his daily duties as chief executive of the publicly traded $19 billion-a-year Fortune 500 company, and in full view of the entire industry. That's what really shocked the audience at the Hyatt. There had always been questions inside the company about the Fourth's fitness for the top job. And when August III prevailed upon the board to name his son CEO in 2006, the widespread assumption was that the elder Bush had made sure there were loyal retainers in place among management and the board of directors who would protect August IV and the company from just this sort of thing. But all the king's horses and all the king's men hadn't been able to prevent the debacle. Clearly, the wheels had come off the beer wagon. Word of the Fourth's performance poured out of the Hyatt ballroom and into the bar, and flowed down the escalator to the main reception room. Within minutes, it was the talk of the NBWA conference. Cell phones flashed the information back to AB home base at One Bush Place in St. Louis, where it was treated as a potential PR disaster. It proved to be worse than that. The Fourth's personal problems, which for years had been denied, ignored, or covered up by those around him, were about to have worldwide repercussions. 3.5 weeks later, on June 11th, InBev, a 4-year-old company based in Belgium, but controlled by a trio of Brazilian billionaires, made an unsolicited and utterly unwelcome bid to acquire Anheuser-Busch for $46.5 billion. When the dust settled on what became the largest cash acquisition in history, America had lost one of its most beloved companies, and more than 1,000 AB employees in St. Louis had lost their jobs. The Fourth and his father were among the executives who made fortunes in the deal. They walked away with nearly $500 million between them. But their long, rocky relationship was by then irrevocably broken. They no longer spoke to each other. Untethered from both family expectations and company responsibilities for the first time in his life, August IV quickly descended into an abyss. According to friends, family members, and court documents, when the police came for him in February 2010, America's last king of beer was holed up in his mansion, grievously addicted to drugs, gripped by paranoia, beset by hallucinations, and armed with hundreds of high-powered weapons, including several 50-caliber machine guns. "It's like the final scene in Scarface," sighed one Bush family member, slipping almost unconsciously into an imitation of Al Pacino as doomed drug kingpin Tony Montana. "Say hello to my little friend." Chapter 1. Beer is back. A crowd began gathering at the brewery gates in the early evening of April 7th, 1933, milling around near the intersection of Broadway and Pestalozzi streets on the south side of the city near the river. As the hands of the lighted clock on the Gothic brewhouse tower approached midnight, the number of people swelled to an estimated 35,000, standing shoulder to shoulder for blocks around, growing increasingly boisterous in anticipation. America's 13-year prohibition against the sale of beer was about to end. "Happy days are here again. The skies above are clear again," they roared out in a raucous chorus. "Let us sing a song of cheer again." Similar scenes played out in smaller scale all around town. Over at Chaim Brothers Cafe at 9th and Pine, patrons sang Irving Berlin's teetotaler's lament, The Near Future, How Dry I Am, while hundreds of customers at the German House restaurant joined in an old Deutschland drinking song, Was willst du haben? What will you
have? We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.